Today I'm going to show you guys how to draw an emote such as this. I'm going to walk you through the exact process of this cozy emote to draw it without an art tablet, with your computer mouse, and also with an art program that is free while you have the trial of it. So it'll be a free to do process so that you can make emotes for your own Twitch, your Discord, or whatever. So all you'll need for this tutorial is just pencil and paper to draw the emote initially, and then the art program Clip Studio Paint to create the emote in digitally, and you can get that for free. Just download the free trial, and so as long as you're within the free trial period, you can make your emote. So we're gonna start by getting out our paper and pencil to sketch. I highly recommend you get a couple of image references up on your phone or up on like a computer screen so that you can see some examples and have some guidance in your drawing. Don't feel like you have to draw things out of your head. This is also a reminder not to trace other people's emotes. You must draw them yourself, but you can take inspiration from others and use them as references. So design your emote to fit a square. It may be helpful for you to, you know, with a ruler, draw a space that is a square. I sort of started out trying to do that, found it wasn't really helping me, and I preferred not to do this, but if that's helpful to you, do that. Otherwise, just keep in mind that you're gonna need to have your emote fit a square space. And if you want some tips on how to design your emote, make it look good small, then I have other videos to that. Things I mentioned in this video will get linked in the description, so if you don't want to like click them right away, you can just find your way to the description later. Otherwise, this one is also in the top right. I have a playlist of emote tutorials to help you learn to draw them as well, if that is helpful to you. So when sketching, don't be afraid to erase and retry. Also, don't be afraid to restart and draw your own emote multiple times and then pick the drawing you like the best to take to the next step. You're gonna have to let go of some of that high expectations and perfectionism that a lot of us, you know, do to ourselves. If you're new to emote drawing and new to even just drawing, you're gonna have to lower those expectations and just practice a bit if you want to improve. And you'll have to maybe draw multiple. Again, if you draw multiple of the same thing, ultimately you'll like one the best and you can move forward with that one. But again, you can just erase, redraw, don't be afraid to do that. And you can see me erasing as I go. I'm typically not one to draw on paper anymore. I'm pretty much exclusively a digital artist, so it felt weird going back to draw with a pencil again. So I did do quite a bit of erasing, which I do digitally anyway. By the time you've finished drawing your emote, you've decided you're happy enough with it. If it's not perfect, there are some tweaking things we can do in the digital program. So let it go. Let's move on. So take a photo of your sketch. You could also scan it, which is even better, but let's be real. Nobody's gonna take time to do that. Just take a good photo of it. Best, you know, tips for taking a photo is to stand right over top of it. You want to be exactly parallel over top of it. You don't want to basically distort the view of the emote by like having a low angle or something. So parallel, directly over top of it. Watch the shadow of your phone. That's just going to be annoying in general. If it's there, I guess, oh well. Getting in some good lighting, natural light like sunlight, not direct sunlight, but a room that's lit up for taking your photo will help you get a decent photo to then take forward into our digital programs. And then once you have your sketch and photo of that sketch, you're gonna need to download Clip Studio Paint. Check out the description of this video to find your way there, or just Google Clip Studio Paint free trial. I also make Clip Studio Paint tutorials, so if you wanna check out more tutorials on how to use the program, just check out my channel. And with that said, now's a good time to mention that you could like and subscribe. So once you have sketched your emote, you're gonna wanna bring that picture of it into your program. So I've already done that here. Easily you can just go file and open and just bring it in. And while I'm teaching you how to do the digital side of this, I'm going to teach you as best as I can, knowing that most of you or a lot of you won't have had much or any experience in digital programs. So I'm going to try and walk you through really thoroughly. One of the things we want to do to start with is just brighten up our sketch. Assuming we've taken a decent picture of it, we can go to edit and then tonal correction, find brightness and contrast. And that's going to bring up this. And we can brighten it. You can even up the contrast, which kind of just helps make it like, well, brighter, more like white, like a piece of paper. So I'm gonna stop it about there. And this will be totally fine to draw over top of. Now we need to set up our emote canvas. So we're gonna go File, New, and we're gonna get set up on a 500 wide by 500 height. That size will do. And I like to do 90 DPI, which is the resolution. And if you're in Clip Studio Paint, you can record the time lapse, which is a nice thing to do. You know, proof that you made this emote and it's fun to watch back. And we're just gonna click OK. Now we want to copy paste our emote that we've sketched here into this square space because it does need to be a square. So we can go select, select all, edit, copy, and go to the new canvas here. Tabs at the top of ones you've been working on. I've got other emotes that I've drawn here. For example, these are ones I've made. And we're gonna do them in the same style. And we're gonna go edit, paste into the new canvas space. Now, if it shows up like this, like, whoa, where did it paste? I don't see it. That's because what you've pasted is way bigger than your canvas space. So we're gonna go to edit, transform scale, and see how big it is. So we're gonna just pull that down. Now you don't wanna distort it because this isn't very helpful. So when scaling down, you want it to hold, you know, the proportions. So what we wanna do is click shift and we can scale it down. And I'm just zooming in and out with my mouse roller, right? So that we're fitting in the view. Now, this is a really important step, how much space we use in our emote canvas is important that we really fill that space up. So I'm just gonna try and maximize that space. So I'm thinking right about there, and you can even rotate a little. This looks like a little rotation might be helpful too. I kind of like rotating it a little bit. And now we've got essentially the sketch done in our emote canvas space. And I'm looking at it thinking to myself, man, I wish I made some different changes when I sketched it. And there's an easy way to make changes to your sketch digitally. So, and this is a step that I do digitally as well. When I draw with digital pen and digital tablet, we can still do this with our mouse. So what we're gonna do, I found the lasso tool, which is here. So this tool here, the selection area, and it might be set to the rectangle to begin with. So just to a side note, all of these tools on the side here, when you click one and change it, the little icon changes. So what you just need to hover over to see what they're called, because the overall category should be the same. So this is a selection area category, even if the icon changes. So the default's probably the rectangle, but we want the lasso tool. And I'm thinking, first thing I'm thinking with my own emote is I want to change this section so that it's more centered to her head. So it's almost like it's a direct on, but she's not actually direct on. So you can select it with your mouse and then edit, transform again. And sometimes these different ones are useful, free transform, distort. I'm just gonna use free transform. And you can drag it over, tilt it, whatever you need to do. So if you are drawing your emote and you need to make some changes, then the lasso tool is gonna be helpful. So I'm just gonna make some changes to help out my emote here, and you can do that for your own. All right, I've made a couple minor tweaks and I'm happy with that. And don't worry if you see like little gaps here, that's where it's transparent, like here, here, and here. If it really bothers you, then you can just make a layer underneath to kind of get rid of that. But in some ways, you know, don't even worry about it. If you want to make a layer, here's new raster layer button. So in your layers panel, now might be a good time to mention that Your Clip Studio Paint may look different than my Clip Studio Paint in terms of the windows. It is worth mentioning that all windows can be moved around and pulled and put somewhere else. So if yours doesn't look the same, don't be alarmed. Just go to window and all of the possible windows that you may need would be in here. So ones that you need open would be things like tool. If we get rid of tool, you can see our tool sidebar is gone. So just tool, that exists. And then we have things like layer. Layer we definitely want. And then things like, what are the other, the navigator might be useful. That's that thing in the top right. What other ones are really important? Subtool is important, tool property is important, brush size is important, color wheel is important. Basically, if you just copy what I have, you should be okay that you can see them. They do kind of like layer together. So like here's history and the layer window together. And you can just pull them around like little tabs. They can even float. I don't know. If you want them to float, just pull them. And so this is my arrangement of things for now. So yes, if you're like, I don't see one of the windows, then just click on the window tab and you can check for all of them that are there. So at this point, you know, my canvas is all on one layer. If you want to make yours all on where one layer, you can go layer, and I've already done so, but you just can go merge visible or merge visibles to new layer or something. So you're just merging essentially, layer, merge that. And we have an opacity slider. This is useful for if your sketch is like dark, you just want to see your lines over top of it. Ours is pretty light, so I'm only going to adjust it a little bit, bring down my opacity a little bit, fades it out to about there so that I can easily see where my lines are over top. Next step, for organizational purposes, I want all my lines, because we're moving on to do line work now, in one folder. So new layer folder, you can see that button here. And I would imagine you can do all that stuff here as well. New raster layer, new layer, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, so the button here, new folder. And within that folder, we're going to make a special kind of layer. And this is such an important thing. Don't skip over this. We are making a vector layer, not a layer, not a raster layer. Those are the same thing. We are making a vector layer, which is going to be super important for doing special things with our lines. Because we are drawing with our mouse, this is very important. Okay, so now we want to start our lines. I'm going to select black to start with for my lines. So go to your color wheel, drag it around, pick black if you want, and then we would like to use our line tools. So we gotta find that. Different than our pen. We're not just gonna try and use like a pen tool or whatever and try and draw like that. Like I'm not, like that looks like garbage. We're not gonna do that. We are gonna make use of digital line tools. So find the figure tool. Your icon might look different. I think the default hotkey is U. So even if you just click U, you might find it. Otherwise, look for figure and it could be one of these little symbols. We are gonna use the continuous curve tool. So that's the ultimately the tool you're looking for. And I'm gonna zoom in a little bit so I can really see what I'm doing. And size wise, let's see, how wide do we want our lines? Well, I usually draw in a size 5. So I think I'll try size 5 here. Let's start with the eyes. And just a note, the eyes are one thing I just do on a separate layer. So I'm just gonna go ahead and click, 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 click. So you see we're on the continuous curve. And easy as pie, we're even making like smooth, smooth lines. So I'm gonna do like that. And for my eyes for now, I just kind of want that to look. And to look like it's spiky is the best way I can word that. Now, if you didn't quite do it perfect and you're like, oh man, I just wish I drew this slightly over, you can easily, this is where vector is important, move your lines around. Look for your correct line width tool or your correction of points tool, line tools essentially. So you're looking for your line tools and we want the one that is control point so that we can move these around. This is what's so amazing about these vector tools. So we're gonna go back to our figure tools, the continuous line curve, and I'm gonna do the other one. You can see how simple this suddenly is. And it does join. So it joins your last or your first point you made, joins it. Now, if you're like, again, not sure this is quite right, find your control point again and drag. I'm just gonna drag it. And if you need to add control points, check this out. This is your tool properties down here. If you want to add a control point, that was my default. You're like, okay, I'm gonna zoom way the heck in. I'd really like my eyelash here to curve a bit. I'm gonna add a point there. I'm gonna add a point here and just like make that curve. See what I did there? So if you want to add points, you can also delete control points. Like, oh, I don't like that. Delete it. Also edit, undo if you need to step backwards. So edit, undo, that's great to have. So I'm just gonna leave the eyes outlined for now. Again, I like to leave my eyes on a completely separate vector layer compared to the one that all the other lines are gonna be on. It's just the way I do it. So new vector layer again, I'm gonna find my way back to my figure tools with the continuous curve, and we're gonna continue curving around drawing this sketch. So double click will end your curve. So like this, double click so I can continue. And I'm just gonna basically line this whole thing. You guys don't need to necessarily watch me do this in real time. So if I come up with something important, I will mention it and we'll slow down. Okay, I've come up with something important. Along with our vector tools, one important vector tool is the vector erase. So can you find the eraser? If you find the eraser, here it is. Find vector eraser. Now, if tools are working differently for you than they are, that like how they apparently are working for me, always check the tool properties. And if you need to make sure they match mine, go ahead. So for example, the erase up to intersection is the one I leave the vector eraser on, so that when, now I'm gonna change my brush size to be a little smaller. There's an intersection, see these are intersecting. I can click on where they meet to get it to erase. And that goes for all the layers that you have here. So these intersect there, and I'm going to erase where they overlap basically. So that's gonna be really useful, and that'll save you time trying to draw your lines perfectly. You just whip out your vector eraser and just erase at intersections, and you'll see me doing a little bit more of that. I honestly use the curve tool in my regular drawing every once in a while when I just can't get like a certain curve shape right. So even I use this tool in regular painting often enough. I think now's a good time to mention a certain thing that's gonna be so important in making your lines look nice. Among our, you know, correcting of points tools and correcting like width and all that, under these tools to edit our lines, you can find the correct line width tool. And I use this one a lot. And we can either thicken or narrow. So I'm actually gonna switch it to narrow, and I would like to narrow on this point. Now, if you're finding, oh, it's narrowing way too much of it, you might need to add a couple extra control points, drag them around to make it work. Because these eyebrows, I'd really like it. And you can't do this without with a mouse. I'd really like it if they tapered into more of a point instead of the line being the same thickness the whole way. So we can edit that by editing line width. So I'm going to go ahead and do that here. And it wasn't quite working the way I wanted, so I'm actually going back in and thickening in the middle. And that's a little bit more of the effect I wanted. So it gets thicker in the middle and then thin on the end. So play with your narrow and your thicken. And what I would like to do is also thicken various lines around the art here. So I'm actually gonna thicken this line. Now what you're seeing, that's too thick. So I'll show you again, but anyway, I'm thinking about a setting of 1 is good. This little green like highlighter wherever the green highlighter touches as you're dragging along is what the line it will thicken. So I'm avoiding these ones and just drawing around there. So that one's already thicker. That looks great. I tend to like to thicken lines around the face. So that one we're gonna thicken. It's looking a little wonky actually. So control point and we're gonna drag. So you can always go back and fix. It's a beautiful thing. You can also drag around. So I would like this line to... Actually, my plan for this line was to narrow it. So I'm going to do that. I'm going to go back and narrow with control line width. Narrow. I'm going to put this at a 1. Like that. There. That's looking pretty good. Control point looking a little funny there. And I'm actually going to delete a control point. That looks weird. Delete. That looks weird. Undo, undo. Remember, edit, undo. And I'm gonna drag them around till they look a little better. I want these to look curvy and not have little awkward edges to them. Here's another really good trick. If you want to like pick up and drag an entire line, find the object tool. Looks like a little cube. And you can just click on the line you want to adjust and you can drag it around and adjust it. So I use this all the time. Useful to do with a mouse as well. So I'm just slightly deviating from my sketch below. Maybe you want to do that as well because you're seeing it differently now and you would like to adjust it. So I am doing a bit of that. Adjust this. And you know what? I'm even going to pull this one out a little bit. Okay, so I've pretty much lined the whole thing and now I'm looking at it finished and I'm gonna make again some edits to, okay, this line overlaps a little bit. I'm gonna vector erase, don't want any overlapping. We're just being picky now, looking for anything we can fix and also doing any final width editing to make them thinner and thicker to give that feeling of variety. We don't need a ton throughout, it's not gonna matter a lot, but I certainly like to see a bit of line width variety. So now what we're going to do is we have two options. We can turn off, there's a little eyeball symbol here, turn off the sketch layer, or we can delete it. I'm going to just turn mine off for now. And friendly reminder to save. Hopefully you've maybe, I recommend saving almost right off the start. So I'm going to save right now. So I'm going to save mine in here with my other emotes that are sort of part of the same thing. And I'm just calling it Girl One. And this is a cozy emote. And it will save as a Clip Studio format. So save. So our line work is done. That's arguably one of the hardest parts. And we've done our job with that. So I'm going to make a new folder. New layer folder. And this folder is going to be underneath the line work folder. Now, if you're really having trouble with layers, I have made a whole tutorial on layers themselves, because if you're new to digital art, that can be like a really confusing topic. So if you're really hung up on that, I've got a tutorial for you and I'll put it in the top right. Otherwise, we're going to move on. So we have our folder here for lines. You can close and open them, collapse them, open them. And we're going to set our line work folder, the folder with the lines, we have these two, and we're going to press this button, set as reference layer. This is really important. Click it. You will see that I didn't even do it right. The whole folder, not even just a layer, the whole folder. If we did it right, you'll see that the folder has a little lighthouse button next to it. So hopefully you can see lighthouse button on our folder with the lines. Now new folder, and this one's gonna have the colors in it. If it helps you, just name them color lines And this was the original sketch. You can name your layers sketch. If you want to be really fancy, color code them. See how I did that? Click this. Sometimes I color code when I'm doing bigger, fancier projects. So these are things that maybe could help. So color folder, inside of that, we're gonna make a new raster layer or new layer. I would like to color in her eyes to begin with. Eyes, eyes, eyes. So find yourself the fill bucket tool. Yes, fill bucket tool. That's gonna make our lives so much easier. And we would like to find the one that says refer only to editing layer. So click that one and check your settings here, the tool property settings, and your color margin and your close gap are gonna help you fill these in. So you might need to adjust these, play with these. I have a tutorial on that too. I'll link in the top right to make life easier if you're struggling with this concept. But basically, we want to use refer only to editing layer, and we can slide these up and down to try and make it work better, and color margin as well. That just tells the canvas where you're coloring, so you can play with that. So simply enough though, we can just click, click, and I'm actually going to use the same colors from this emote. I forgot, I made myself a palette, so I am going to use this palette. You can just pull colors off your color wheel or whatever you need to do. So I'm gonna make this a floating color palette. I'm gonna just keep it over here. That should do the trick for us. Color palette. And if you want a color pick, find your eyedropper. And I would like to eyedropper the skin color. So I'm doing it to match this one, sort of medium skin color there with brown hair. And fill bucket, looking good. That's pretty easy. So each section you color needs its own layer. Now, if we go back and look at our eyes and oh, look, there's all these like gaps here, gaps. Oh, we didn't fill those in. This is a good time to get out the pen tool and maybe fill that in with your pen and that, you know, using your hand to kind of draw. So I'm drawing there, drawing there, drawing there, and here. There we go. Now, this is a me thing. You don't have to do this step. I like, and this is why I put the eyes on their own layer, I like when the eyes are one with the lines. So I'm actually gonna drag. You can drag by click, drag, drag this layer into the line work folder. It's gonna become one. And I'm gonna merge these two together. So you can select them and go merge selected layers. The other way you can do this is by clicking the one on above the other and finding the combine to layer below. Boop, now they're one layer. That's gonna be useful to me. And this is also me just being a little fancy. Please ignore this step if you're lost and confused and this overwhelms you. But I just like a little bit of a feathery look on the tips of my eyelashes for this kind of eye. So I'm finding a brush tool and I'm gonna make the size of the brush a little bigger. And we'll see if this works with my pen tool or my using a mouse. I've not really tried this. Kinda. The other thing that might make it work a little better is the pencil tool. So actually that looks decent. So we're gonna just use our, I'm taking out pencil tool and just kind of lining that and just play with it. Now we're literally drawing, which we haven't done much of that. And you can also erase as well. Sometimes one of the ways you can erase with the tool you're drawing with is instead of picking one of these, you pick the opaque one, and that actually lets you draw with transparency. So now I'm technically erasing. So, but yeah, if that confuses you, just slide on by this part. A little advanced, maybe, tip for you. Okay, and back to coloring the skin. I see we have a little gap there. I'm gonna eyedropper skin color again, find my pen tool, and just color that in. I'm just being thorough. Okay, now the way I'm gonna show you guys to do this is to color in all the sections first, and then we'll apply shading. to the various areas like the skin. So flat color means no shading, just the base color. So new layer, I'm gonna add the base color of the hair. So eyedropper, if you need to use it, and I'm gonna fill, refer only to editing layer, and fill these in. Huh, interesting. See how this didn't fill in properly? Well, we can increase close gap, see if that helps. Nope, that didn't help. Increase color margin. Yep, that helped. So now we are filling in properly. If it's filling in too much, like it's filling in the, filling in the whole canvas, then like that, your color margin might be too high. So you can just play with that, adjust it as you go. Okay, new layer. We get to choose what we want the little outfit to be. I'm gonna just do the, I clicked off of refer only to editing layer. So click that. I'm gonna color those black. New layer, I'm going to color the blanket white, or that's not white, that's like a very light pink. Light pink on the edges. New layer. And a darker pink on the other parts here. So that's the look I'm looking for. Now, if you've gotten here and you're like, oh, I'm doing this right now. I wish I hadn't drawn a line right here. It's not too late to fix. You can go back to your line work layer, which we have here, and I'm gonna find, I would like to erase it. So I'm finding my vector erase, and I'm actually erasing this here. I think I like the way that's gonna look a little better. And because we erased after the fact, after having colored in, I need to fix the coloring. So I'm gonna go back and just manually color that in this case. That should do it. So when you're making edits after the fact, that gets hard. That's why it's really, really ideal to make sure you are happy with your sketch before you do the lines, and that you are happy with your lines before you do the coloring. However, reality is that it can be very hard to catch everything that's going to bother you, and it might be too late. But hey, we will get better at this with practice, and we will do our best, and we can't expect perfect on our first attempts at emotes. So be kind to yourself. If your emote does not look as good as mine, please be nice to yourself. I've been doing these for like 5 years. So just as of now, please be nice to yourself. It takes a lot of practice. And I'm just gonna color that section in black. All right, now one of my very favorite steps in all of this is creating a border and making our emote pop. So I always like to jump the gun. You could do it as a last step, but I like to do it at this step. Once all our flat coloring is in, I'm gonna find our layer with the lines and I'm gonna duplicate it. So we're gonna go layer, duplicate layer. Now, this is important. We need it to be at the very bottom. Pull in layer order down, all the way down. It's above my sketch. Sketch is kind of irrelevant now. It is the last layer underneath everything. Okay, and we're gonna go to the object tool. So once again, can you find our cube object tool? Click object. And while you're selecting the correct layer, which is underneath, you can adjust the brush size. I like to put mine at 18. So there we go. Now we have a nice little border thick for us to make our emote pop, and it's only against the transparent areas. One thing that's really good to do along the way when creating your emote to see if you're even on the right track is to check how it looks small. So what you would do to check is go layer, and we want to merge the visible layers. This step is important because if you don't merge everything before checking, it will mess up your lines because vector lines are special. So because vector lines are special, just merge everything together. It's a flat image now. And now we can go to edit, change image resolution. And you're gonna get this little window, and we know that emotes are 28 by 28. Type that in, click okay, and make sure your view is at 100%. So view 100%, okay? And now you'll get a sense of this is what my emote's gonna look like tiny. Now, I have created other tutorials on how to make your emotes look good small, so I have two videos really on that. First one is how to make your emotes look like not distorted when small, so you can check that out. And the other one is 10 tips for basically making your emotes look good small. So those may be tips if you're like, ah, it doesn't look good small. Those are gonna be ones you're gonna wanna check out. So I'm gonna undo. So when you're checking these things, you're gonna have to go edit, undo until you're back to this with all your layers so that you can keep going. All right, at this point, I like to start coloring the eyes. Now we know that the eyes are in the lines folder. That is okay. This is how I do it. I'm gonna add some coloring to the eyes from here. So I'm gonna click on my eyes layer, then click new raster layer. The layer is gonna end up above your eyes layer, and you're gonna wanna click clip to layer below, and you'll find that one here, clip to layer below, these two little squares. You'll see a pink line, and that attaches to the layer below it. That will make it so that we can only draw on the area below on the first layer it's attached to. So let's not get ahead of ourselves. To demonstrate, find yourself the airbrush tool. This is the tool that I use when I'm adding a little gradient effect for the eyes. And I like to pick like a red. So airbrush tool, these didn't come with the program. Just find something that says like a soft, but either way, just find an airbrush tool, doesn't matter. And make it kind of big enough so that it's about this size and you can kind of brush. Now that's a little harsh. I'm thinking I want to turn down the opacity or intensity of this brush. So I'm just gonna hold the opacity of it down. You can see how this shows how we're adjusting the tool. So I'm just gonna make that soft, and you can even just single clicks if you wanna see how that goes. I like this as a style, just adding little red to the tips. And I even go as far as now doing a more of a skin color and adding that in. I'm gonna decrease my brush size and just a little bit there. Optional step. This is just how I do my fancy emotes. I'm giving you guys the whole process on my fancy emotes. Okay, and then I'm gonna pick like a light blue, and I'm gonna actually take a brush tool and make little circles, because I don't know, this is just what I do. Little circles, and those are too intense. So I'm gonna take our opacity and turn that down. I'd like to look at about that. So we have two layers attached to our eyes to color them in a sense, add the details, and they're both clipped to this layer with the blacks of the eyes. So let's go back and look at our color folder with all of our colors in it and find our skin. This is where we're gonna start. Again, click the skin layer, new layer, clip to layer below, hence Clip Studio Paint. Amazing, clip. Now I already have the color of skin I would like to picked out. All right, so again, it would be really hard potentially to color using the mouse. Ooh, that's hard. So we can find ourselves the continuous curve tool again, and well, color in. Well, that doesn't seem like coloring, does it? It will. I'm gonna undo and try and edge the space. So I'm gonna create the shadow of her forehead like that. Find your fill bucket tool, and legitimately you're just gonna fill that in. Magic, love it. All right, back to curve line tool. And again, if these tools aren't working right for you, check your sub tool property settings here, your tool property settings. And if they don't match mine, try to make them match mine. And yeah, hopefully that works for you. Okay, I would also like to create a new layer on our skin and brighten the center of the face. I feel like this is a good strategy. So I already have a color picked out. Boop. Airbrush tool. Now I'm gonna make the airbrush tool bigger. How big do we want it? Bigger than that. Too big. And click the middle of the face. Click, click, maybe a couple times. We've brightened the middle of the face. Maybe it's too bright. Opacity slider, can slide it around. I'm thinking that looks good. There, skin shading done. Hair is probably gonna be your most complex shading, especially if you're doing long hair, so bear with me. New layer, clip, find the color you wanna use to shade the hair. And back to your continuous curve tool. And I like to think of them as little U shapes. There's a U shape, there's a U shape, or I don't know, upside down U shapes. U shape, U shape that kind of line the top of the hair. That looks good. In some ways, doing it this way can be just as fast as doing it with an art tablet, crazily enough. Let's color these in. Boop, boop, fill bucket, boom, boom, boom. Getting the line tool out, and I'm going to create other sections of shadow. So same thing. Apply the shadows where you want them to go, fill bucket, and just fill in those sections. Oh, not filling in properly. May need to adjust some of this stuff. Color margin down. Perfect. So I've got the shadows of my hair. I'm gonna make a layer again for my highlights. That's gonna go underneath my shadows because I want my shadow ones to be on top. So you can easily just drag these layers above and below each other as needed. You can see what that does. All right, we're gonna add some highlights along the edges of her hair. So I'm gonna take this color here, another color that I had picked out, and I'm gonna find the continuous curve tool. I'm gonna make it a little thicker. And I would just like to line sort of the edges of her hair. So sometimes I like to put, you know, highlights on edges. So that's what we're gonna do. There's some nice little highlights in her hair. And we have to do the old classic, like, highlights around the, I don't know, what would you call that, rim of the hair? I don't know, like, okay, so we're gonna do that. The way I did it here was brush strokey. So I'm gonna give you an option. The easy way to do this would be take your highlight color, I'm gonna use the same color, and you can find your continuous curve, make it thicker, and you're literally just gonna do one of these. That could be your like main highlight for that. If you wanna be fancier, I'm gonna erase what's on the layer, and we're going to attempt to use the watercolor brush and kind of brush that in. This might not work as well as we want it to, so we're gonna try our best. I think for this to work better, I'm just gonna reduce amount of paint or density of paint, maybe both. Aha, I like this look. So play with your subtool settings. This is gonna give me that brush strokey look. So good luck practicing this with the mouse. Might not be the easiest. There, not so bad. That works. I'm okay with this. And I might even erase again. Use the... It's not an eraser, technically. It's just painting with transparency. Click our little checker instead of our color checker and kind of erase into what we've done. And that might help, too. Maybe make it worse. Okay, we'll do our best here. Just keep going back and forth. Add some paint, take some away till it looks the way you want. Don't overthink it. These are kind of abstract shapes as is. So I'm gonna stop there. One more thing I had with my hair design is little dots of highlight. So I'm just gonna quickly and easily do that. Once again, new layer, make sure it's clipped. And I had this light color picked out. I think drawing a little circle would be easiest just with the pen tool. I'm just gonna grab a pen tool, and you can either just like literally click your mouse like that, maybe make it bigger, click mouse like that, or you can just try and like make a smaller brush and try and do the circle yourself, but probably easier just to get the brush size the way you want it and do a little click. So that's all I'm gonna do for that. Maybe one more, because sparkles. Yes, there. Okay, that was definitely the hardest part, coloring hair, for sure. Need a whole tutorial on that. Maybe I'll be making that soon enough. We want to add shading to the other parts. I'm gonna go ahead and shade the darker pink part first. So new layer, clip, and I've got a shadow color already in mind. Again, curve tool, and oh, that's gonna be too thick to draw with, so escape, let's redo. And I'm gonna pick this size. And I'd like it to go like that. Like that. Find your fill bucket. Fill those in. So far, so good. Super easy to do it this way. Now, this isn't a tutorial exactly on like how to shade. I recommend getting some references, seeing how others shaded similar types of emotes so you can kind of get a feel for it. But in general, we're just applying shadow where we think shadow would go. Okay. One little thing I like to do, and this will be easiest taught again with the line curve tool, is I like to add, you know what, I'm just going to show you. New layer, clip layer. All right, I'm going to use the same color that we used before, this like lighter pink, and we're going to take continuous curve, and I just like to edge where the shadows go, just against where they meet other shapes. So I kind of just like the way that looks. Optional, of course, style choice that I make. I just think it looks nice. All right, so we've shaded that part. Let's do the exact same things to the light pink parts of the cozy blanket. I don't exactly have a color pre-picked for this, so I'm actually gonna just kind of make one. Now let's say you're doing what I did just now and like, I see I've applied my shadows, but they don't look dark enough, or it's not the right color, and you would like to change the color of something you've done. Because things are on separate layers, this should be an easy change. So find yourself this button, lock transparent pixels, click it, and find the color you'd like to change it to. I'm gonna darken this slightly. And then I'm just going to take a pen tool, make it big, and just color over top of the whole thing. So we just changed it. Did you see? So like if I want to make it black, see like it's black. Ooh, you can see some flaws in my coloring. Good thing we did this. Undo. See, even I'm not perfect. And we're going to fix our gaps. So in order to now draw again on this layer, you probably need to turn off the lock transparent pixels. It's locked. So unlock it. And now I can go ahead and add that section back in and fill in. If you really want to be particular, emotes don't really matter. You can zoom in and look for the errors, like, ooh, probably right there. Like, big whoop, probably not a big deal. Probably okay to leave that. Okay, we're gonna call the emote done. That's all there is to it. Easy to color, like, easy. Okay, I say easy, possible. With practice, easy. Otherwise possible to do with a mouse and digital art program. Hey, I'm back real quick. I forgot to add one important step to this video because people ask me about it a lot, saving and exporting it. So all you're gonna do when you're done, you're gonna go file, you're gonna go save as, and you're gonna click the file type, and it needs to be a PNG file. PNG allows for a transparent background, which on that note, you need to make sure that you don't have any layers underneath still turned on, like your sketch layer, maybe just delete it. No paper layer, nothing needs to be transparent. We want that to have colorless around the edges so that in Twitch chat, it will just be empty in that space. So you can go file, save as PNG, or you can actually click the PNG button. It says export in PNG. Do that and name it, save it. And then when you upload to Twitch or Discord, you're good to upload as is. You don't need the 112 by 112, the 50, whatever it is, the different sizes, that's old news. Twitch now lets you basically any file size. So just literally Simple Uploader, if Twitch is what it's called, will let you upload the file and you're good to go. Badges is a different story. You still need the different file sizes, but I'm sure they'll change that eventually too. So hopefully that answers that part. You can check me out on Twitch. I'm ShyFox on Twitch, twitch.tv/ShyFox. And you can come and catch me live, ask me questions about emotes and other art related things there. In the description, I'll have links to things mentioned in the video as well as my own social medias otherwise, so you can check all those things out. If you found the video helpful, please do like and subscribe. It really helps me out. That would be really kind. I also have more teaching videos on Clip Studio Paint, so if you enjoy this program, which I highly recommend this program, it is like the best. The tools are amazing. I feel like this video should have demonstrated just how great this program is, that you don't even need an art tablet if you're patient and want to learn this way, okay? So this program's amazing. I do have more teaching videos on Clip Studio Paint specifically that can help you improve at it. And with all that said, leave comments if you have questions about anything. And I don't know, I guess I'll see you in another emote video another time. Have a good one. Bye.